This program is an Encore presentation. Welcome to Faith Works Live. Here's your host, Rebecca Haney.
Great to be with you here on this lovely day the Lord has made. He is still on the throne. Nothing takes him by surprise, and we can trust him. He is unchanging, the same yesterday, today, and forever. His loving kindness never fails, and we can run to him as a shield and refuge. There you go. That's your good news dose. I know I need that. I need that reminder each and every day, because I don't know about you. I'm just tempted to like get caught up in all the little distractions. And I mean, maybe some of it's good stuff and it needs to be done, and that's wonderful. Somebody's got to do those dishes and those diapers. Like, it's just it's a matter of life. Someone's got to fill out those TPS reports by Monday. That'd be great. but nonetheless, don't let all the little stuff crowd out the big grand vision that the Almighty Creator of the universe knows you, loves you. He smiles when he thinks about you. That's what we talk about on Theology Thursdays here on FaithWorks Live. My name is Rebecca, and I am just pleased as punch that you're a part of this. We are live as well on Facebook, on our live stream, on our FaithWorks Live Facebook page. And right alongside and along for the ride is Josh Bingaman, as you so often are on Theology Thursdays, and lead us so capably through these sometimes rocky waters of theological discussion. But you do it very well. Thank you, Josh.
Oh, thank you. Glad to be here.
It's always glad to have you. And I always feel like I learned something no matter what. So that makes it a good day for me.
I better make sure what I say is true then, because people apparently are taking notes.
We were just talking about that. Like, is it better to have dead air or bad theology on the air? Like, we just may have to shut up for a second. If we get into mistakes, we're like, oh, okay.
Whoops.
Well, I guess that's wrong. 1 second, pause for flipping Bible pages. Okay, let's get back into the Word. And that's going to be our strategy, right? We're not perfect. God is. And so that's why we go to Him for our answers.
Amen.
And we are, of course, nothing without our capable producer, Ron Carlson. Ron, it's so good to see you. How are you?
Just fine and dandy.
Oh, that's good. All right. So now that everybody's good, everyone's starting on the same page, proverbially, let's blow things up.
Yeah.
So interesting, a couple of things that happened over the last couple of weeks. We got into it over the Rise and Fall of Mars Hill podcast.
That was last week.
A lot of that has to do with questions that people have over biblical manhood and womanhood. And so there were some interesting comments that were coming about that I got some feedback from that. And so I just want to clarify, in general, we're not defending every single thing that Mark Driscoll ever said, far from it.
True.
Or the attitude with which it was said or anything like that. But what we will say is that a biblical view of manhood and womanhood tends to be very different, very countercultural. And it is, I think, still to this day, and we'll stand by it, a wonderful thing to tell people to turn to the scriptures to look for who you're supposed to be. If you want to man up, that's a wonderful message. If you want to be a godly woman of courage and integrity, then yes, we need so much more of that in our culture. But don't trust other people's definitions of what that means. You need to go, first of all, to God, to the Word of God. And then I would say also go, men, go to older men that you trust in the church.
Yes.
Go to women, go to older women that you trust in the church that can give you that example, that witness, that testimony, that advice that you might need. And I think, you know, honestly, one of the, I mentioned in the passing, but one of the issues that Mark Driscoll had was he was trying to tell women how to be good wives, and he had no frame of reference for that whatsoever.
Yeah. And, yes.
And he was, well as, you know, advocating his own opinions and preferences about things with the authority of scripture, which it's not. And doing some other things that were sort of bullyish, it certainly seems. And
it's a mixed bag, right? There's a lot of good there and some that's not.
Yes. So he's not the arbiter of biblical anything. God's word can speak for itself. So I invite you, everybody, to go there. But just because it's something that's countercultural doesn't mean that it's necessarily anti-God, anti-biblical. We've got to understand and affirm the word of God no matter what. Which brings us, I think, to today's conversation pretty nicely. See how that happened? That
was good. Full circle there.
Stand alone on the word of God. But do we?
We want
do
to.
We certainly do. We talk a lot about it. And hopefully we're all studying our Bibles every single day, diligently feasting on that as the Word of God and learning the God of the Word through the Scripture. But are we sometimes picking and choosing just the parts that we like. Are we faithful to the fullness of Scripture? And we got a question about this from a real live listener. So very glad you're listening, even if you disagree. You had quite a bit of conversation about this. We thought we definitely want to address this on the show because it's a worthy question and it's a common one.
Yeah, I actually commented with it many times. So if you go and look at the old show, what was that, 2 weeks ago?
A couple weeks ago, yeah.
Yeah.
Way back in the day.
Oh, back in my day. we commented back and forth, and we basically came to the conclusion that we don't agree. You know, so
agree to disagree.
It was respectful and everything. But ultimately, you know, we're not really here to comment on him, but rather the ideas that the one idea that he presented that Christians are a contradiction to themselves, and that they are picking and choosing what they want from the Bible. And he shared a couple videos and said, "Hey, this reflects what I think that you guys are saying, and that it's ultimately hypocrisy is what the idea is." Christians are hypocritical because they'll focus on homosexuality or something, but they'll totally ignore other things. And so ultimately, if you are a hypocrite, then it robs you of the authority to speak. Thus, shut up.
Right.
That's
sure.
the idea.
I don't have to listen to you because you're inconsistent with your own standard, and therefore, you know, you don't have, again, the moral high ground to be able to tell other people how to live their lives.
Yeah.
Which is, you know... That's not the first time that argument has ever been made.
Yes.
And hypocrisy hunting is popular, and many times it's even warranted, right? Because we want to be consistent with our standard. There's a reason that we hate hypocrisy, that we hate to be called hypocrites, maybe even more. But the hunt is not to be right or to be able to point out everybody who's wrong. The point is to come together mutually around the truth.
Yes.
To say every single person is subject to a standard. Right. So let's find the standard that is best. Let's find what is, you know, right and wrong that can be applied, that everyone can equally, you know, fall into and under. And if we disagree about that, which clearly we do, then the question tends to not be, you know, well, you've got your truth and I've got my truth, because that doesn't really resolve those core tensions, unfortunately. But let's tackle that, because one of the very smart points that you made, Josh, is that it's not as though Christianity has never heard this objection before.
Correct.
We've actually been debating it, thinking about it, talking about it, teaching about it for centuries, millennia even. And so I just thought, yeah, let's dig into that for a little bit and see how far we get. See what we can come up
with. Buckle your seatbelt, because there's a lot here to unpack.
There really is.
Let's play the video.
Let's play a little bit of a clip. So this is a clip from a show called The West Wing. And
so it's an old show. It came out a long time ago.
This is entering into a narrative. So this is a scripted show, and this is expressing, I think, pretty clearly the writer's opinions or the creator's of the show's opinions. But it encapsulates many people's objections to Scripture or to Christians presenting moral commandments per se from Scripture, and we'll see. Well, let's just listen and hear how the argument is presented, and then we'll see, you know, are there some valid points here? What would our answers be, and what does God's word have to say about all of this?
Yeah.
People participating in the political and social debate through call-in shows, it's a good idea to be reminded every once in a while. It's a good idea to be reminded of the awesome impact. The awesome impact. I'm sorry. You're Dr. Jenna Jacobs, right?
Yes, sir.
It's good to have you here.
Thank you.
The awesome impact of the airwaves and how that translates into the furthering of our national discussions, but obviously also how it can... Forgive me, Dr. Jacobs. Are you an MD?
A PhD.
A PhD?
Yes, sir.
In psychology?
No, sir.
Theology?
No.
Social work?
I have a PhD in English literature.
I'm asking because on your show, people call in for advice, and you go by the name Dr. Jacobs on your show, and I didn't know if maybe your listeners were confused by that and assumed you had advanced training in psychology, theology, or healthcare.
I don't believe they are confused, no, sir.
Good. I like your show.
Neither of us are doctors, right?
Yes.
Okay.
I like how you call homosexuality an abomination.
I don't say homosexuality is an abomination, Mr. President. The Bible does.
Yes, it does. Leviticus
18:22.
Chapter and verse. I wanted to ask you a couple of questions while I had you here. I'm interested in selling my youngest daughter into slavery, as sanctioned in Exodus 21:7. She's a Georgetown sophomore, speaks fluent Italian, always cleared the table when it was her turn. What would a good price for her be? While thinking about that, can I ask another? My chief of staff, Leo McGarry, insists on working on the Sabbath. Exodus 35:2 clearly says he should be put to death. Am I morally obligated to kill him myself, or is it okay to call the police? Here's one that's really important, because we've got a lot of sports fans in this town. Touching the skin of a dead pig makes one unclean, Leviticus 11:7. If they promise to wear gloves, can the Washington Redskins still play football? Can Notre Dame? Can West Point? Does the whole town really have to be together to stone my brother John for planting different crops side by side? Can I burn my mother in a small family gathering for wearing garments made from two different threads? Think about those questions, would you? One last thing. While you may be mistaking this for your monthly meeting of the ignorant, tight-ass club, in this building, when the president stands, nobody sits.
Oh, look at that. Isn't that so much fun?
Award-winning TV show, by the way.
Actually, it was. Yes, yeah. It did win many awards. I've never really been into it, though. So they say a lot of things there, a lot of things that maybe some of our listeners have heard before, seen someone post on Facebook. They addressed a lot of issues of the Old Testament law, mm-hmm. of sexuality, morality, all these things. Fundamentally, big picture here. First off, he got some of the laws a little bit wrong, and also the punishments way wrong.
Yes.
The Bible does not encourage the death penalty for every crime. My gosh.
Also, that's, no. Yes.
So even in the Old Testament, the things that he was saying, just completely fundamentally wrong about the death penalty for sowing different kinds of crops, mm-hmm. or different... that. My gosh. Yeah. Okay. But still, in the bigger picture, he is clearly not speaking... First off, it's a scripted show, but the character here is not speaking from any kind of biblical knowledge of what hermeneutics is or what Christians actually believe, mm-hmm. about the Old Testament and the New Testament.
Okay. Well, and I think we'll come back to it right there. We'll address some of the big points. I think that's critical, especially when it comes to slavery, sexuality, and shellfish, right? Mm-hmm. And we'll look at, I think, God's word in context. And are there times when we're maybe as modern, maybe non-Jewish Christians, we're not obeying some of those things that God gave in the Old Testament? Why not? So we'll talk about that when we return.
The good news is always on your beacon. Iowa's Hope 940.
In today's world, security has never been more vital. And at FaithWorks Live, we're proud to partner with Verigard Security. It's a professional physical security service, and they're really raising the bar in security and private investigations. Whether you need a team of professional officers to protect what you have worked hard to build, or their mobile security units for multiple properties or large locations, from business or corporate properties to your home or neighborhood, perhaps you've got an event coming up, they secure quality security coverage for events large and small, because it's about peace of mind and protecting you, your family, your team, and your property. Settle for nothing less than the best when it comes to your security. You shouldn't have to compromise. When it comes to security, you can trust Verigard. Contact them today at verigard.us. That's VARAGuard.us. For security service, you can trust Verigard. There's no better time than now to stand for life, and you can stand with Iowa's original pro-life organization, Pulse for Life. They're the longest-standing nonprofit pro-life organization in Iowa, and they're dedicated to informing, educating, and inspiring a new generation to value the sanctity of all human life, from fertilization until natural death. They serve at the State House, they educate in classrooms, at events. They proudly serve on the coalition of pro-life leaders. They are on the front lines of the battle against this throwaway culture of death that we see all around us, and we are winning ground. Hearts and minds are changing, and the pro-life movement is continuing to grow. And you can be a part of the exciting things that are happening right here in our own backyard at pulseforlife.org and get your finger on the pro-life pulse. Sign up for their newsletter, find ways that you can make a difference and how you can change hearts and minds with their pro-life apologetics course, pulseforlife.org.
This program is an Encore presentation.
So glad that you're here on Theology Thursday, specifically here on Faith Works Live. We could not do the show without the fine support of our friends at Agape Pregnancy Resource Center. They deserve your support, in fact, because they provide wonderful free services to women in crisis in our community every single day. They do that because, number one, they love these women. They love these babies, these whole family trees that can trace their lines through the doors of Agape. They love helping and serving people in the name of Christ. And they believe women deserve the truth about their pregnancy, about their bodies, and about their baby. And that when women have that support, they can choose life. They are empowered by the truth and that love. But they can't do it without the help of folks like you. And there's a great way to support them coming up. Their big fundraising gala coming up on the 28th. So just a few short days away, there's still time to register. Go to agapedsm.com. That's agapedsm.com. Click the button right at the top that says register. Register for the night on March. I don't even know. What day is it? What time is it?
I think it's September.
Back in the way back machine. Next week, the 28th is coming up. I would register now at agapedsm.com. I'm glad that you're here. Josh Bingaman is here. My name is Rebecca Haney, and you're listening to Faith Works Live. You're also welcome to join the Facebook chat as well. And today we're talking about sexuality, slavery, and shellfish, and or why do we seem to pick and choose, we meaning modern day Christians in the 21st century, why do our lives look so much different than some of the commands that God gave to the ancient Israelites, for example? Is there kind of an Old Testament versus New Testament way of living? Or, as is often kind of raised as an objection against Christianity, are you just picking and choosing the parts of the Bible you like or you want to obey? And the kind of club passages to say, well, you don't want me to live this lifestyle. You don't want me to have sex with this person. You're evil. You're awful. You're a hater. But you're a hypocrite. Yeah. And that's worse, so I don't have to listen to you. And we kind of got a secular summation that was raised to us as an objection. And characterizing, I think mischaracterizing Christians' understanding of Scripture. But let's tackle it.
Yeah.
Let's tackle it. It's a worthy point to address in its entirety.
Yeah, and there's the fundamental issue when people say things like this is, first off, yes, Christians can make mistakes. Christians don't are... I fundamentally believe
Hello,
we are.
Have you met us?
Yeah. I fundamentally believe that we are all ultimately hypocrites in one way or another because none of us live up to our own belief system, our own code. That is a part of human nature. We call this original sin. We are all sinners, even not only violating God's law, but even violating our own moral code and different things. And so, first off, just a step of humility that there absolutely can be Christians who are not living consistently, and that is a problem. But that's a whole different thing to say that Christianity is false because it inherently is hypocritical. I don't think that that is true. And I think that any argument that they are making about that is misguided and wrongly understanding how the Bible is put together. Because as you brought up, there are two different covenants. Mm-hmm. The Bible is not one book. Okay, it's actually 66 books, and it is written over 1,500 years, but it is formatted into two separate covenants, two promises made by God to his people. And not everything articulated in the old covenant is still applicable in the new covenant. And that's ultimately what answers most of the questions that were brought up in that video clip we listened to a minute ago.
I think it's important to distinguish as well between different types of commands that we see in the Bible, because there are some moral commands that are put in place, like the Ten Commandments, for example, cover things that are... you may have heard of them before.
I'm down with
for
it.
The big. And God doesn't really abolish those types of... He says, this is true. And you shall have no other gods before me. That's going to be true for all people at all times. And when you obey that, great. When you disobey that, you're sinning. sinning. It's a problem. But then there are also commands that he laid out for his people, the Hebrew people, that were specifically more lifestyle things. That's where you get into the dietary restrictions, the clothing, and because they were to be a people set apart. And many of those are directly addressed in the New Testament. For example, dietary codes, huge debates, lots of dissension in the early church days because you had Gentiles coming into the church in large numbers, and you had different questions now. All right, now that we're no longer just one ethnic group, basically, we have to deal with these diversities, these different ways of living. And so the Apostle Paul addresses this quite a bit, and in relationship to Timothy. So when we're reading about Paul and Timothy's adventures, a lot of that is addressed there. But, I mean, that's if you're interested in consistency among Scripture. Scripture is remarkably consistent.
Oh, yeah.
But there are different types of teachings for different groups of people. I think that's important historical context to understand. And then much of that is directly addressed in the New Testament when the Lord says, all right, my kingdom is open, not just to the Jews. My chosen people are not just the people of Israel now, but it's of everyone of all nations who comes to me under the name of Christ. There is now no longer Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is, you know, this male nor female, actually, is how that passage ends. So there's this great equalization that happens, an open door that Christ is the way for all peoples, and certain commands carry over. We see that. And certain commands are kind of said, all right, well, what God has called clean, do not now call unclean. Acts chapter 10.
Ish.
Ish. 10, 11. when Peter meets Cornelius is a really big example of this. So I just wanted to lay that as groundwork that.
Exactly. Yeah. And that basically the two fundamental ideas are, like you said, is that there's the civil law, which is the law of Israel that no longer applies today because Israel, the covenant is expanded beyond that. And also they have been left behind because they were rejected the Messiah. There's the ceremonial law, which is the Old Testament religious law. But we're under a new system with a new sacrifice. And so we no longer have the temple. We no longer wear those kind of robes. Those all things, those are gone. But the moral law still
persists.
Like
women can actually come in and worship in the General Assembly, whereas we were not allowed to before. The women were in one outer court basically,
then
men were allowed to go into the inner court area. That separation is done away with.
That
is a beautiful
done.
thing.
That was a ceremonial thing. It was never a moral thing. But another way that's even simpler,
just an example
that fits in the law right along this one, is basically this idea that any of the Old Testament laws that are reiterated in the New Testament still apply. Anything that is not mentioned in the New Testament, we often see as being closed, finished, completed by the work of Jesus. Now, of course, there are some things that people will say, oh, well, it doesn't say, you know, bestiality in the New Testament, so, you know, have at it. No, actually, don't.
Do not.
Because
it does.
The New Testament condemns sexual immorality of all types in there. So generally, if you just want a simple rule, how do I know what's what? Anything that is reiterated in the New Testament, we find as binding, or as some people like to call it, the law of Christ. And so that's a real simple way to understand. And there are other things, like you're talking about the dietary law. Well, Jesus, not only did we have the prophecy came to Peter, but also Jesus clearly said this. Mark says this in Mark chapter 7, verse 19. Since what goes into a person was it verse 18. Then are you without understanding? Do you not see that whatever goes into a person from the outside cannot defile him, since it enters his heart and not his stomach and is expelled? Thus he declared all foods clean. And so here in Mark, it explicitly says that Christians are no longer bound by the dietary laws.
And then Peter still didn't get it for a while.
Yeah, you know.
And then the application to say, hey, I love all people, and all people of all nationalities and backgrounds are now welcome in Christ. As many as believe in him shall be called sons of God. So that's good, good news. We'll return for more of it coming back on FaithWorks Live.
Your Beacon, Iowa's Hope, 940.
Hey, what's for dinner? If you're like me, I hear that 15 times a day. And fortunately, I have a plan. It's typically Onimus beef at our house. We are such big fans of Onimus beef at the Haney home because it's just great quality beef. There's no steroids or antibiotics. It's naturally raised butcher beef. They sell by the quarter, the half, or the whole, and they support your local meat locker, so they can help you get it processed in a way that works for you. In this economy, it's good to have affordable options for your meat. And if you're willing to make a good investment in your nutrition for a healthy menu plan, I highly recommend Onimus Beef. Contact Dave and Mary Lynn at onimusbeef.com. They welcome your questions. They'll help get you on the schedule. They have locker dates coming up. Don't wait. Secure your locker date today. Go to onimusbeef.com. That's onimusbeef.com.
Stay up to date on all programming changes, contests, and special event announcements by joining the Hope 940 email club. It's free and it's a great way to stay connected. Signing up is easy, so go to iwashope.com and click on the email club banner. As a member of the Hope 940 email club, you can be first to hear all about programming changes, contests, and special event announcements. So join the Hope 940 email club today at iowashope.com. Information that matters to you and your family. This is your beacon, Iowa's Hope 940.
When a woman faces an unplanned pregnancy, every possible emotion goes through her head. Where can she go for help and for hope? She can go to InnerVisions. Here in our metro, we have two healthcare clinics where she will find hope and help. From free pregnancy testing and STD testing to free ultrasounds, InnerVisions serves women and men with STDs who find themselves in vulnerable situations. They're completely free of charge because of generous donations from folks like you. And their medical clinics help their patients get all the information that they deserve that empowers them to make life-affirming decisions. That's what they do at InnerVisions Healthcare Clinics right here in Des Moines. Learn more at InnerVisionsHealthcare.org. That's InnerVisionsHealthcare.org. And you can call 24 hours a day at 515-440-CARE. That's 515-440-2273.
KPSE Des Moines. A Des Moines Radio Group station.
This program is an Encore presentation.
We love Bible study.
We
love the Bible
do.
Here on FaithWorks Live. And my name is Rebecca. I love it. And we're digging into some scripture and maybe some difficult passages. You probably heard some of these objections before. So if you want to take notes, if you want to listen up, if you've got some thoughts and some ways that you've been thinking about this that's helped you, we would love to hear it. Join in the discussion. We're also live on Facebook, too, so you can chat with us there. I'll keep up with those comments today.
We try.
Now, Josh, you, as we so frequently need to remind people, are skilled in this.
Well,
you have these types of conversations all the time at Harvest.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we do.
And so this is, I think, just an example of people thinking, yeah, I would like to have answers for this. I'd like to know what God's word says. I'd like to know what those centuries of thought about this in among Christian thinkers. Like, I want to join in that type of discussion. I'm all ears. How do I do that?
Well, I'm glad you asked, because Harvest Bible College right here in Des Moines is available to you to answer these precise questions. We have our apologetics class that answers these exact things. We go through all the different arguments for the existence of God. We go through atheism and the new atheism. We go through world religions. We go through the resurrection of Jesus. We go through all. It's such one of my favorite classes. I love it. But we also have a wide variety of classes available, whether it's studying through the Bible, Old and New Testament, particular books of the Bible, Romans and Galatians, or whether we're studying theology, or whether we're doing something more practical like leadership or like counseling. We have a lot of different classes available to equip you to serve the kingdom of God. And so whether you're looking to just take a course, maybe even just audit a course for half price, you can do that. You can check us out through our website, harvestbible.college. You can sign up for our next semester, which starts in January. Or maybe you want to take a full load. You don't want to just take one class. You're like, hey, I have a calling into ministry. How do I step into that? Well, you start by getting the biblical education, because every denomination, we work with the open Bible churches, but every denomination has educational requirements before you can ever even think of becoming a pastor. And we meet those requirements. And so if you want to step into ministry, the first step is to consider a biblical education to prepare yourself for what God has. And so you owe it to yourself to go to our website, check us out, harvestbible.college, learn more, send us a message, get set up for our next semester in January.
harvestbible.college. Now, we were talking so far about sexuality, slavery, shellfish.
Yeah.
And all those objections, right, that you might get to say, well, how can you tell me that I can't do this in my bedroom with my body, whatever that might be, when you don't keep every single aspect of, in particular, Old Testament or Levitical law? There are several what you might call gotcha passages in the book of Leviticus and Deuteronomy. And that's something that I think Christians should have an answer for.
Oh, it's absolutely true. There are some passages that need to be discussed, that we need to be educated on to understand, whether it's tattoos or how you sow fields with grains and all these things, because it's interesting it's in there. It's very clear that the Bible, especially in the Old Testament, was written a long time ago. But that's also key to understand. Part of the reason why some of the things are the way they are in the Old Testament law and code is because they hadn't even invented prisons yet. You won't see a prison sentence in the Old Testament because there were no prisons. They were literally a nomadic tribe when the law was first given.
When you move from place to place, you're not building prisons and you don't have infrastructure really to be able to provide for that. So you do have a lot of lifestyle and cultural commands and teachings that have to do with developing an identity for a people that is other and set apart and holy and is also moving around all the time.
Yes. And so that helps us understand why certain laws have these certain punishments to them. It's either death penalty or something else. There's never anything in the middle. That's why. But that's also why when Christ came, he didn't reinstitute these same laws. We no longer practice the death penalty for these certain sins anymore. So when people say, you know, who are you to stop me from? Actually, we're not. We're not stopping you from doing anything you want. Whatever you want to do in your bedroom, it's legal right now. You can do that. I'm saying it's immoral for you to do that and that there will be a judgment to come. That's a different conversation. No one is stopping you from being the person you want to be. I'm just saying it's not wise.
Mm-hmm. Well, and if we look in context at immorality, which is repeated in the New Testament. So we talked about some things that are lifestyle stuff that's mostly for the nation of Israel at a certain time that is now, we might say, is complete, that Christ has fulfilled that.
Yes.
I think that might be a good passage to think about when Jesus said, Matthew chapter 5, for example, verse 17, he says, I've not come to abolish the law and the prophets, but I've come to fulfill it. Mm-hmm. And heaven and earth will pass away, but not a jot or tittle will pass away from the law until it is accomplished. So he's respecting those commands and upholding those commands as well, because he can fulfill them. We cannot. We could not, and our fathers and our forefathers and nobody else could keep those laws perfectly, which is why we needed Jesus Christ as the sinless sacrifice in the first place. So that's just a little more of that broader theology that I think is important in context.
Yeah, you know, people, I have a joke that I like to tell where, you know, people say, oh, the church is just so full of hypocrites. You're right, but there's always room for one more, and that's you.
Come on in.
And that's the Christians need to be humble. We need to be humble. But also, we are not claiming to be perfect. We often don't. You'll often hear Christians say, I'm not perfect. I'm just telling you about the one who is. Mm-hmm. And so when we tell you about God's law and God's requirements and all these things that exist in true reality, we are expressing the words of the one who made it all, who knows all, and is looking to save and redeem us. Mm-hmm. We are messengers, not kings ourselves. And sometimes I think people mix the messenger and the message up.
Well, and it's easier to decry the faulty messenger.
Yes.
You know, there's a lot of faults. It's a target rich environment. Yeah. I have problems. I have flaws. I have faults. I have hypocrisies. I'm sure that I do. I have blind spots. But that doesn't change the holiness of God.
Yeah.
That doesn't change the perfection and the worthiness of God. I know I'm unworthy. Like, you don't even know. You don't know the half of it. But thank God for him, for his grace. Thank God for the blood of Jesus Christ that cleanses us from all unrighteousness, that all of us who are unworthy, every single one, can come together under Jesus Christ. And God imputes his righteousness to us.
Amen.
We so don't deserve it.
No.
But that's how good he is. So I think that should be the reason we all stand up and cheer instead of turning like pointing fingers at one another like you're unworthy. Like, I know, but but God is awesome.
But also when we bring up, you know, God's requirements, God's laws, the things that we say are more immoral or whatever, people don't want to hear that. They don't want to be called immoral, even though they don't believe in our God. They still don't like what our God has to say. And so they want to find a way to disqualify. That's often why they'll say, well, your Bible says this, so thus I don't have to listen to you. It's kind of very similar to when you're making an argument on Facebook and they're like, ha, a grammar mistake. Your argument is invalid.
Invalid.
it's like
but
no.
What about that's the bigger point? No, not going to address that.
Precisely, right? Because first off, there are no mistakes in the Bible, but there are things that are difficult to understand.
Right.
That do require understanding the difference in covenant, do require understanding the whole of the Bible to make sense of this one piece. Mm-hmm. And that's why we have theologians. That's why we have pastors.
Right.
But people often are just looking for an escape hatch to not listen to the convicting message that's being given them.
Many, many, many times it's about sexuality.
Yes.
That's the trigger. Right. And we go to Leviticus and people are like, wait a minute. God's telling me who I can and can't sleep with. That doesn't jive with what I want. And so I have to throw out all of scripture so that I can be right about what I want to do. And if that's your attitude and that's your motivation, I guess at least be honest about it.
Yeah.
But ultimately, none of us get to just do whatever we want because we're not the judge and we're not the standard and we're all bent rulers out there. If we just did whatever we wanted to, the whole world would probably look a lot like it does right now, actually. But God's moral code, God's standard of righteousness is the only one that really matters. Like, my opinion doesn't matter. And it's going to be flawed anyway if it's just my opinion.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I don't think pistachio ice cream should exist. I think that's a cruel joke. But I'm sure there are people out there that like it. But broader point, God's standard is the one that matters. And so because I'm trying to submit my life under God's standard and say, all right, I know I'm falling short, but he's the one that gets to say set right and wrong, not me. Then really, this isn't about my opinion. It's about what the word of God says. So if we go to scripture and people are like, well, I don't like what the word of God says. Okay. Doesn't change it.
Yeah,
like,
it's still the truth.
It is what it is. So I think that's maybe just a rather freeing point for people to say, you don't have to defend yourself so much if this is brought up as an objection, because we all just kind of admit to the fact that, yeah, we're pretty screwed up no matter what. But God's not. And it's if we care about his standard, then we have to listen to what he has to say and not try to twist it into something that
wins.
And one of the passages I think that is interesting about morality in the New Testament is in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. And it's one that has been tried to be reinterpreted many times, but it lists many things that are considered immoral.
Mm-hmm.
And it says, here's its impact on eternity. Do you not know that wrongdoers will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither the sexually immoral, which we can define, we know. See Leviticus. Nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who have sex with men, nor thieves, nor greedy, nor drunkards, nor slanderers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. That's a pretty big list.
Yes.
But there's a major point, a major addendum to that list, which we'll get into when we return.
The good news is always on your beacon. Iowa's Hope 940.
Mr. Smith?
Yes, doctor?
The test results show that you have 3 completely blocked arteries.
3? That sounds bad.
Actually, it's amazing you're still alive. We need to perform triple bypass surgery as soon as possible.
Wow, this is serious. When should you operate?
I have a space open tomorrow morning.
Tomorrow? Oh, that's not enough time for me to get in shape.
Get in shape, Mr. Smith?
Yeah. I don't want to have an operation without being in good health. I need to quit smoking.
I don't think you have the time.
And drinking. I need to stop drinking.
Mr. Smith, you need major surgery.
Yeah, I know, but I want to be in good health first. And a haircut. I need to get a haircut.
Why would anyone wait until they were in good health before they had life-saving surgery? Many people have this same attitude about going to God. They feel they need to clean up their life first. The problem is, we all have a life-threatening disease called sin, and the only cure is Jesus. Are you trying to be good when you need to turn to Jesus?
Another message from Lifeline Productions, the comic strip of radio, at lifelinepro.com.
The good news is always on your beacon. Iowa's Hope 940.
This program is an Encore presentation.
You got to feed your family. This is what I know. They all want food, 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 which means you got to have great quality food and you love them. What's more? So feed anybody that shows up at your table great quality food by going to animusbeef.com. That's a good place to get started, because Well, let's just say word has gotten out and they've gotten really, really popular. All right. So you got to get your name on a wait list in order to get your beef. But that's OK, because it's well worth the wait. It is quality beef and it's wonderful, just naturally raised Angus beef. Delicious, good in just about anything, but you don't have to take my word for it. You can get some for your family, get on that wait list, like I said. So you probably want to do it now. And they can help you out with all of that and help explain any questions that you might have. Happy to answer it. OnimusBeef.com, highly recommend. Onimus is OnimusBeef.com. All right, you're listening to Theology Thursday, where we just decided to, you know, go full throttle into
we got it.
The biggest cultural objections that we have. We talked about shellfish, mm-hmm. talked about sexuality mm-hmm. a little bit, and we're going to talk about slavery. We'll get in depth on that, because that's a really big and I think worthwhile discussion we need to be equipped to have. But right before the break, one of the most important passages specifically in the New Testament, right? Because we talked about the difference between old and new. Mm-hmm. We understand things that are reiterated in the New Testament. We need to pay special attention to that. It's God's law still in effect for all peoples at all times.
Yes.
So when it says this is right and good and this is immoral, as it does in 1 Corinthians. So Paul's writing this to the church at Corinth that was having a lot of issues defining sexual boundaries.
Yes.
Right? So they had that same issue where you had people who were well-trained in God's law of Jewish background, and you had other people who were being influenced by all manner of crazy things. And they're coming into the church and they're bringing in things that are quite outrageous, outrageously immoral, like incest, like mm-hmm. all kinds of weird relationships. And God says, no, this is not how we're going to do this in my kingdom. And here's what I mean. Do you not know that wrongdoers will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither sexually immoral, nor adulterers, nor idolaters, nor men who have sex with men, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor slanderers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. That's a fun list mm-hmm. of all the usual suspects, right? That's not where it ends. And such were some of you.
Yes.
The people I'm talking to right now, the people of God, these Christians in the church that are saved and sanctified, that was once part of their story, that long list. But you were washed. You were sanctified. You were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. That's what makes all the difference.
Yes, because we are not, it's not us versus them. It's not the holy people versus all you sinners out there. That is not how it should be. This is not what the Bible says. What it is that we are all sinners. We are all fallible. We are all weak. We have all fallen short of the glory of God, and we are all in need of salvation of Jesus Christ. I am a beggar just as much as any other man in this spiritual world. But I am a beggar who has found a source of food, and I'm trying to tell you about this nourishment that is only found in Jesus Christ. Come and find what I have found. We are not better than you. We are not better than anyone. But we have found the one who is perfect, and his name is Jesus.
Right. And none of my inconsistencies should tarnish him.
No.
But I think that's part of that standard is that you can minimize what you'd rather not be true anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes that's the point of this discussion. I do think these are areas where we should engage with people, believers, non-believers. We should talk about these kinds of things. We should talk about it from the confidence that says we serve a holy, wonderful, righteous, faithful, merciful, just God.
Amen.
So it's not about me and my imperfection, blatant imperfections. It's about understanding who he is and what he asks of us, requires of us, because he is worthy,
mm-hmm.
right? And so in that worthiness, we often fail in our obedience. But he clearly says, you know, this matters. This matters for eternity. And so if you're seeking these answers because you say, I really don't want to hear what God has to say anyway, so I just want to discount it and be able to check it off in my list and kind of move on and do my own thing,
mm-hmm.
then that's where you are. You know, that's where that type of heart and that type of person is right now. If you're listening to this, well, I'm glad you made it this far. It's really kind of an honor that you've been listening.
Yeah.
And I would invite you to ask God who he is on his terms.
Yes.
Ask God and invite, you know, just try at least reading scripture, see what God has to say to you. I believe he will answer you. John is a good place to start.
Yes.
But if you're wrestling with some of these things, maybe you have a church background and you're thinking, actually, I don't know. Mm-hmm. I don't know why we don't eat these things or wear these things or why we're still saying that this sexual sin is wrong, but it's okay to, you know, worship this way instead of that way. This is the type of conversation that we need to have because we need to be well educated in the foundations of our theology. Specifically, though, I think the argument about slavery comes up quite a bit among well-intentioned, well-meaning people that maybe just aren't aware of exactly what the Bible says on slavery. They just know it contains those words and talks about it. And I will say evil people have historically used and abused passages of scripture to justify American chattel slavery, for example, specifically in the South. Yeah. And that needs to be debunked on its face.
Yeah. So the Bible does talk about in the Old Testament about the strictures of how slavery can exist. And it basically, if you owe a debt.
You mean Americans didn't invent slavery?
No. Slavery pre-exists. The Bible's writing, too. It already existed then.
Sadly, every culture has had some form of this.
Yes. Yes, it is. It has been an issue. But the kind of slavery that is described in the Old Testament is basically what we call debtor slavery, is that you owe a debt that you cannot pay. So instead, you can sell yourself into slavery. And so that's fundamentally how it works. They also were, you know, prisoners of war and things like that. So there's some exceptions.
So it's a lot like people who have student loans today and have to work in order to pay them off.
Well, it's actually, yes. This is more of kind of, and you, when we talk about slave, now the kind of slavery that exists in Egypt with the Jews, now that was more of a chattel form of slavery based on racial lines.
Where you could be born into it and have no freedom. You have no choice whatsoever. And that is not what God condones in the
Israel Old Testament. Was always against such a thing because they experienced it. They were a people that formerly were slaves, been freed, so they never legalized any kind of slavery on racial lines or birth lines. Even if a person was a slave and they had a child, that child would not have been born a slave. That child was born free. And in fact, every single slave person who was a slave was only a slave for a certain amount of time. There was always a contract that was signed. Maybe you're a slave for 7 years, maybe longer. It just depends. Mm-hmm. But it's just the debt that you owed had to be paid and it would be fulfilled at this time. Plus, the Jewish country nation had the year of Jubilee. And part of that, in addition to all debts being forgiven, all slaves were set free.
Every 50 years?
Yes, every 50 years. And so the Old Testament did have a form of slavery. We might still not think that that is great. But the issue is that all of our clothes often come from sweatshops today. The things that you're wearing, the shoes that you're wearing right now, was probably made in a sweatshop in Indonesia or South America or somewhere like that. And you don't have a big problem. You probably don't even think about it. But the truth is, that is much more akin to the kind of situation that was in the Old Testament. Mm-hmm. I don't like it either.
Right.
But most of us aren't actually doing anything about it.
Yeah, perhaps
maybe
we could.
Yeah, but maybe we should be. But it's not the same thing to talk about that kind of scenario to then look at the American South and that kind of chattel slavery. That kind of chattel slavery is absolutely condemned in the Bible. It says, do you have it there?
Exodus 21:16. That the punishment for kidnapping someone and selling them into slavery is the death penalty.
Yeah, here it is. Whoever steals a man and sells him, and anyone found in possession of him, shall be put to death.
So if somebody was kidnapped, which is what we describe in the American slavery experience, sadly, they should be freed, but their kidnappers or anyone else who's a part of that or holds that person as a slave will be put to death.
Yeah, the slavery that exists in the American South was absolutely unbiblical, immoral, and deserving of the death penalty, not only for the slavers who took the people, but also for the people who purchased them and the people who had possession of them. It was wicked. It was evil. The Bible clearly condemns it. And when the Bible talks about slaves obey your masters, it is not talking to that kind of scenario. It is talking to a very limited form of slavery that still we may not like, but it's not the same thing as chattel slavery that existed.
And I think that puts a whole new understanding when the Bible says things like you were slaves to sin.
Yes.
That you put your body under the submission of sin. That you were chained to sin, going to die. You're sentenced to death. That the wages of sin is death. But now you can be free through Jesus Christ. Like, that just makes you want to stand up and cheer, doesn't it?
Amen.
That makes you want to say, but wow, the free gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. Not only, now we have a whole new master when that happens. options. We can't serve two, right? We'll either be slaves to sin and suffer all of the worthy wages of that, or we can follow the good shepherd who laid down his life for his sheep. He sets us free. That's where we'll leave it here on FaithWorks Live.
Information that matters to you and your family. This is your beacon, Iowa's Hope 940.
Come here, son. I want to show you something really neat.
Okay.
See this cocoon? Well, in just a bit, you'll see something really spectacular.
Cool. So what's going to happen?
You'll see.
Nothing's happening.
Well, a little patience, son.
But it's just sitting there. Dad, nothing's happening.
Trust me, son. If you just wait a bit more, you'll be impressed.
Dad, this is boring. Really boring.
Just give it a second, son.
This is dumb. I know. Let's step on it. Can I, Dad?
No.
Well, can we throw rocks at it?
No, son.
This had better be gooder than TV.
I've seen this before, son. Trust me, you're gonna love it.
Even if it appears like he isn't, God is at work in your life. God knows far more about our future and our needs than we do. Are you willing to trust him with every area of your life?
Awesome, Dad. A butterfly.
I told you it'd be spectacular.
Another message from Lifeline Productions, located on the web at lifelinepro.com.
Stay up to date on all programming changes, contests, and special event announcements by joining the Hope 940 email club. It's free and it's a great way to stay connected. Signing up is easy, so go to iowashope.com and click on the email club banner. As a member of the Hope 940 email club, you can be first to hear all about programming changes, contests, and special event announcements. So join the Hope 940 email club today at iowashope.com.
How often do we spot the angels or feel the unseen hand? Most times are tough, but going rough, like there never was a master plan. Those steadfast doors don't open, and you pray, but you don't understand. You've gotta hold fast the hope that's in you. Don't always trust your eyes. Sometimes it takes a long time to see it as a blessing in disguise. We live upon this dark surface, God, he moves upon the deep. What is concealed will be revealed. There is no promise he won't keep. Still we're confused by the shadows. We're awake now, but we're half asleep. That's the hope that's in you. Don't always trust your eyes. Sometimes it takes a long time to see it as a blessing in disguise.
Sometimes the dark can move our for the light of the sun. And our ways don't become his ways until we are undone.
Hold fast the hope that's in you. Don't always trust your eyes.
blessing in disguise. And after you've been broken, you may not realize that you are grace to the brokenhearted and a blessing. A blessing in, you are a blessing in disguise.
Is always on your beacon. Iowa's Hope 940. KPSC Des Moines. A Des Moines Radio Group station.
Overslept again. What do I say this time? My aunt died. No. Traffic was heavy. Good. I'm sorry I'm late. No. More sincerity. I'm sorry I'm late, sir, but the traffic was heavy.
Good morning, Jensen.
Oh, I'm sorry I'm heavy, sir, but the traffic was late.
What?
I mean, I'm sorry I'm traffic, but the late was heavy. I mean, the heavy was late. Did I mention my aunt died?
Excuse me?
The traffic was heavy. Yeah, that's it.
You live across the street.
It was really heavy?
Honesty. It keeps life simple. Another message from Lifeline Productions, the comic strip of radio at lifelinepro.com.
The good news is always on your beacon. Iowa's Hope 940.